Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Live from this year's Acton University, Dr. J is Al Kresta's guest on his eponymous radio show, From Ave Maria. Between workshops, they're discussing the issues related to the sexual revolution, a culture hostile to life and family, ideologies opposed to gender and marriage, and more.
Right now, I'm being joined by Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, who's been a frequent guest with us here on Kresta in the Afternoon. She heads up the Ruth Institute, and your work has been, the last few years, focusing on the casualties of the sexual revolution. And that's tied in with you got three talks you're doing here that are unified around the theme of, quote, the sexual state.
Yep.
What is that?
The sexual state is my way of saying that the toxic sexual culture that we live in did not just emerge out of nowhere from the culture. It was created by the government. It was created by the cultural elites and enforced and kept in motion by the state and with tons and tons of propaganda. So each of the three talks, and I do hope people will go to the Acton website and look for these talks, because you can purchase these lectures. You know, if you aren't lucky enough to be in Grand Rapids now, you can certainly purchase these lectures. But the first one is called The Sexual State and the Culture of Death, which is really about contraception, what I call the contraceptive ideology. They don't want me to freak out our Protestant friends by saying contraception's bad, like right in the brochure. But but actually, a lot of our Protestant friends can handle it. I mean, they get it.
Sure.
They get it. So that's the first talk. The second talk is on the divorce ideology, which is, again, completely created by the government. I mean, it just wouldn't exist without the change in the legal regime.
Yeah.
And then finally, what I call the gender ideology, which has to do with, which started off as feminism and which has morphed into transgenderism, which is completely at odds with the original version of feminism. So that's what I'll be talking about Friday at the very last session of this conference.
I just saw a column by Camille Paglia.
Oh my gosh, isn't she something?
Yeah, but point really outraged that feminism should have more transmogrified into this transgender ideal.
That's right.
This idea that the state, that this is actually an extension of government power.
Yes.
The utilization of the government by certain elites. I mean, this was when Daniel Patrick Moynihan released his report back in 1963, maybe, on the perils of the black family. It was originally well received, but within a matter of a month or so, again, primarily white elites.
That's right.
Yeah.
He got shouted down right away because these people wanted to be fooling around themselves.
That's right.
You know, I mean, I hate to be blunt, but not everything in life is simple.
Yeah.
But some things are simple.
Yeah.
They just wanted to be messing around themselves.
Yeah.
And so the idea that you would be judgmental about family structure, family form, you know, they've been working on that, breaking that down, going all the way back to the 60s, like you said, you know.
Yeah.
And so the one of the things I'll talk about in the lecture on the contraceptive ideology is the fact that the Supreme Court decision in 1965, which overturned Connecticut's...
This is Griswold versus Connecticut.
The Planned Parenthood people and their, I guess you would say the forerunners of Planned Parenthood, they've been working on that, Al, for 30 years. For 30 years, they came every year to the state legislature of Connecticut, overturn this, and every year... The legislature said, get out of here. We don't want to do that. That's going to upend all social morality. You know, just get out of here. Leave us alone.
you know?
And so, and eventually, the court did it for them.
That's
because
right.
They couldn't get it done by the elected representatives of the people. And that's what I'll be talking about tomorrow. And how that pattern, and the pattern of deception, Al, that's what freaks me out. I mean, I get so mad because people would say to them, people would say, you're going to, this is this is going to harm public morality. And they'd say, oh, no, no, you can regulate it. You don't have to let high school girls have it. My goodness, that'd be terrible. Unmarried women? Oh, my goodness, no. It's only for married women with serious health issues. That's what they said.
These
decisions always minimize.
Be reasonable. We're not going to take it that far.
They knew perfectly well what they were going to do. Literally, the same day Griswold came down, one of the attorneys was on the phone talking to somebody about overturning abortion restrictions.
Yeah.
They knew exactly what they
were doing.
Where
this was going.
Yeah.
So again, this isn't done by the people. This is done by, again, cultural and especially legal elites.
Right.
So you got Griswold versus Connecticut on contraception. You got Roe v. Wade.
Obviously.
Okay. We now have gay marriage as a result
Completely. And I think anybody who's alive today can see that that was not a popular movement.
No,
you know, that
no.
that was manipulation of public opinion by the media elites and then rigging things by the political and legal elites. I mean, how many people voted in favor of man-woman marriage and had their ballots essentially thrown out and themselves called bad names because they voted for it?
That's
right. It's terrible. So, and then the other piece of it is, of course, divorce. You know, divorce restrictions were not loosened because ordinary people thought they were terrible. Divorce restrictions were loosened because of the American Law Institute and the Family Law Bar. And the Family Law Bar continues to block any effort to reform divorce. It's astonishing. Just in the last couple of years, people have tried to do some type of divorce reform that would reduce the incentives to divorce and so on. And it's always the Family Law Bar that shows up and throws a bunch of money into lobbying at the last minute. And it's sickening. It's sickening.
Can you give people some idea of the consequences of the sexual revolution in terms of hurt and numbers?
Well, you know, Al, we are now doing a workshop that we call the Healing Family Breakdown spiritual workshop. We've done them a couple of times in Lake Charles, and we're about to do them in other places. And if people are interested in bringing this to your parish or your diocese, we can make it so it doesn't cost the sponsoring organization anything. You know, you just charge people to come, and that covers it. But, you know, we find a lot of the people who come are people who were either divorced against their will, which is what no-fault divorce does to people. You know, the government takes sides with the person who wants the marriage the least. The government takes sides with the adulterous party, with the pornography addict.
Yeah.
That's who the government's siding with. And then lots of children of divorce, Al. Adult children of divorce. I cannot even tell you how painful that experience is for people. I've had people, not too long ago, I gave a talk to a bunch of college students. I think there were about 150 students in the room, and I was told, I didn't even see this, that a student ran out of the room crying. She was crying the whole time.
I believe it.
I've been there, I've had a situation where people my age, people in their 60s, ran out of the room crying because they couldn't take it. And to think about that, 50 years ago, 60 years ago is when this happened to them, you know, and it's still too painful for them to talk about. So we're trying to help people find the words, find the permit. We're giving people permission to feel what they feel and to say whatever they have to say about this situation.
45 million children of divorce. Yeah.
Well, that's my estimate, Al.
29 million children of singles.
Yes, what I did is looked up, you know, how many children of unmarried parents have there been since 1988, or how many children of divorce have there been since 1974, you know, and you look it up, you add it up, and you go, that's a lot of people. That's a lot of people, and they're all, and the thing you know from psychology is that trauma that is untreated gets worse.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So if you don't address it, It accumulates, you know, and it gets more and more painful and compounded. And people are told by the culture, by their own family, it's okay, you'll get over it, it's fine, your parents are happy, what more do you want? Mm-hmm. You know, surely you didn't want us to be happy, we'd have been terrible parents, blah, 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 blah. And the kid's sitting there thinking, well, actually, I just like to sleep in one bed all the time. You know, I kind of just like to know where my homework is every night. You know, I mean, kids don't, really, it's completely unfair what we're asking of children. Yeah. And then to compound that by never allowing them to speak truthfully about it, by telling them to be quiet, you know, come on.
Put on a happy face.
Come on, you know. Yeah. And the thing is, people, in that situation, people feel that love is fragile. They feel that their parents' love for them is fragile. They see people walk away from each other if things go wrong. And so they're afraid to rock the boat. They're afraid to be the one who says, you know, Mom, this stinks. You know, or Dad, I don't really want to see your new girlfriend. Or, you know, whatever it is. You know,
they
don't want to
say it. It takes some significant courage for even a teenage kid, early 20 kid, to say that.
I mean, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I mean,
and so what's not unusual, Al, is to see particularly the boys to get angry and just start breaking stuff and, you know, get kicked out of school, you know, and all these type of things that they didn't used to do before, you know, that starts coming out. That's how they're trying to deal with it.
Yeah.
They're trying to deal with what's going on. There's no outlet for them.
So the Ruth Institute is helping victims become survivors and then survivors becoming activists.
That's right.
I get that. So the healing is what you're doing, and then motivation for action.
That's right.
What can be done at this point? Because, as you point out, the state makes these decisions apart from the legislature. It makes it through the courts. What do we do with that? I mean, Brown versus Board of Education relied a lot on sociological evidence, which claimed that there were negative effects, that the doctrine of separate but equal, right, didn't work,
right,
because black children were suffering poor self-esteem. Okay. They introduced sociological evidence there. Is anybody trying to do that with the consequences of the sexual revolution and go back
know,
and say,
you know,
look
honestly,
at this?
Honestly, we have tried to do that. In the Obergefell decision, we submitted testimony, you know, or not testimony, what do you call it, amicus brief.
Yes.
You know, we submitted that. A number of people submitted that type of evidence in their briefs. But I think one way in which we've been hampered, Al, is that a lot of people on our side were afraid to say children need their own mother and father. There were a lot of people saying kids need a mother and father. But people were afraid to say they need their own mother and father. And the reason is, I mean, because I was around a lot of the politicos, you know,
yeah,
a lot of the political people. Yeah. And, you know, they've got bosses and friends in the political sphere who've been married two or three times.
Yeah.
And they did not want to take on the divorce issue at the same time. So the way I look at it is, and then the gays would come back to us and say, well, if you're really worried about kids, why don't you worry about that? So our response at the Ruth Institute is to say, you're right, we got to deal with this. And we don't have any pending legislation on the table. There's no political fight. There's no election. Let's just talk about this. Let's get this out in the open. Let's deal with it. And let's create a publicly acceptable conversation, yeah, about the harms of separating kids from their parents.
Yeah.
And then our guys could go into court and could go into the political system with something a little bit more to work,
yeah,
with.
Yeah.
Right now they don't have anything to work with.
No. Very good. How do people stay in touch with you?
RuthInstitute.org.
Okay.
Or go like us on Facebook and catch up with us on Facebook.
Okay. RuthInstitute.org. You've got some great materials here, too, that people can get a hold of.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Thanks so much, Al.
Thanks. Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse. I'm Al Kresta.
Just been listening to Dr. J speaking with Al Kresta about marriage, divorce, family life, prevailing culture, and the sexual revolution on Ave Maria Radio's Kresta in the Afternoon. Stay tuned for her talks from Acton, which will be coming up in our podcast stream this weekend. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.